Recorded Books presents an unabridged recording of Finding Fish by Antwone Quentin Fisher, with Mim Eichler Rivas, narrated by Tony Penny and Antwone Quentin Fisher, including an interview with the author. This work is copyrighted 2001 by Antwone Quentin Fisher and Mim Eichler Rivas. This recording is copyrighted 2000 by Recorded Books. Antwone Quentin Fisher is a producer and screenwriter working in Hollywood. His credits include the screenplay for Finding Fish, the upcoming 00 Soul, and Trigger Happy. He lives in Los Angeles. In the spring of 2001, while Finding Fish was in production at the Recorded Book Studio in New York, Antwone Quentin Fisher took time out of his busy schedule to talk with us about his extraordinary and inspiring life. You'll find that interview on the final cassette or disc. Finding Fish begins with the following note from the author. And now, Finding Fish.
For my wife, Lynette, and my daughter, Indigo, my entire world. Author's note. This is a work of nonfiction. The events and experiences detailed herein are all true and have been faithfully rendered as I have remembered them to the best of my ability. Some names, identities, and circumstances have been changed in order to protect the integrity and/or anonymity of the various individuals involved, and especially to protect the orphans and foster children I have known, who have a right to tell their own stories if they so choose. Though conversations come from my keen recollection of them, they are not written to represent word-for-word documentation. Rather, I've retold them in a way that evokes the real feeling and meaning of what was said, in keeping with the true essence of the mood and spirit of the event. Save the Children, Marvin Gaye. Pre-Memoir, An Uninvited Guest. This beginning part is for my father. This is your story. I wasn't there, but I put it together from what the family remembered, and from what I dreamt. You may think it's not my place to tell. Maybe so. But aside from your blood that's in me, this story's just about all I have of you. I guess that makes it mine, too. The year was 1959. The time, a Thursday morning, the second Thursday of June. This was in Cleveland, the kind of big Midwestern city that made for a good place to raise kids and dreams. The economy was thriving then thanks to the motor companies, the steel mills, tool and die factories, and the other industries springing up across the landscape every which way but north, where the great, ominous expanse of Lake Erie is all that the eye can see. Cleveland in the 1950s was a proud place, a righteous place, a brand-name city. Ford, Republic Steel, White Motors, Fisher Body, Stroh's Beer, a family city. It was work and church. It was a ball town, football and baseball, especially baseball. It was music, too. Gospel, doo-wop, jazz, blues, and the symphony. It was the birthplace of Superman. Cleveland was already a big city, on its way, at one point to reaching number 5 on the list of largest cities in America. But to men like Horace Elkins Sr., a hard-working father of 8, it still had that small-town, friendly feeling. True, he liked to keep himself and his family close to home, safe in the bounds of the Glenville area. This was the working-class, predominantly black neighborhood near the lake, nestled comfortably between the main arteries of St. Clair and Superior, which were linked by 105th Street, forming an I shape. Up and down 105, as it was called, at the grocers, the five and dimes, thrift stores, barbershops, mom-and-pop record shops, clothing, shoe, and liquor stores, and in the neon-lit lounges, residents and merchants were on a first-name basis. On the street, strangers were scarce. Horace knew and trusted his neighbors. They knew and trusted him. More than trusted, they looked up to him. A man felt good to walk proud among his own. Nothing made Horace more proud than his family. That's why he was forever telling his sons, "Get yourself a rib. Find a woman, settle down, raise children, be a man." Friendly and small town it could be, but Cleveland living was hardly easy. Like the weather and the work, the temperament was harsh. And Horace also understood there was an air of danger in the daily hum, something seductive but lethal. He wondered sometimes if that sense came from the Choctaw in him, the way he always felt on guard. When he could, Horace liked to shake those superstitions. They represented the old ways, the primitive beliefs brought up from Arkansas, where he was raised, and the slave ways that went back to the Elkins, West Virginia plantation, where the slave master Elkins had passed his surname to Horace's stepfather, who insisted Horace change his name from Barnett to Elkins. They were ways not of living, but only surviving, that had migrated north with his people and stayed with them, even after they left behind the plantations and reservations. Horace fought the old ways that lurked inside him because he wanted more from life than a subsistence diet of fear and faith. So he fed himself an education, in night classes and on his own, studying the works of Shakespeare and Edgar Allan Poe, and the philosophers from throughout the ages. Through philosophy, literature, science, music, and art, Horace Elkins became a learned man, a free man, a doctor of medicine, in fact, and in spite of the modest apartment on Parkwood Avenue in which he and his family lived, a kind of noble man. Knowledge to him was power and redemption. Knowledge, that is, and the Catholic Church. The Elkinses were strict Catholics. This, too, for Horace, was a further rejection of the old ways. But even so, he couldn't entirely rid himself of ancient instinct. Sometimes, those uneasy feelings had to be heeded. Rising at 4:30 a.m. that Thursday, as he did every day in order to catch the bus on time that would carry him to the first of his two jobs, Horace woke to the shattering blast of a gunshot. He sat up, waiting for the aftermath. But nothing. A dream, that's all, he thought. Too vague to mean anything. Horace washed and dressed quickly and went into the kitchen, where Emma had already prepared his breakfast and was setting it out for him on the kitchen table. He took his seat, bowed his head in silent prayer, and then began to eat. Emma went back to the stove and stood watching her husband, waiting to see if he needed anything. For a moment, she was young again. Before nine babies, back in Forest City, Arkansas, looking for the first time at Horace, the light-skinned young man with his Choctaw warrior nose, who bowed as they were introduced, saying, "Hello, Miss Emma." Like him, she was a blend of red and black, Choctaw and African, whose lineage could be traced to the slave plantations of Alabama, and she felt she belonged with him. She was thin then, a little slip of a girl, but strong, Horace saw, and she was stronger than he could imagine. Over the years, as the lines of her body widened and curved, her position of authority was recognized not only in the family, but within the community. Everyone around had heard stories about Emma bringing home other people's hungry children and feeding them right along with her own nine kids. Emma was strong, and her word was the law. Back in the days when Horace came home every night complaining about his job at the hospital laundry where his white boss cruelly mistreated him, she lifted him up each time, reminding her husband, "But it's a good job, Horace. Look at what we trying to build for the family. You stay with it, Horace. Just hang in there. We almost where we need to be." He listened to his wife because when she felt something, she felt it strong. And Horace would leave the next day, girding himself for more abuse. Then, one afternoon, hours before his shift was normally over, he came walking up Parkwood, lunch can in hand, whistling. Neighbors out on their stoops and on the sidewalk were surprised to see Mr. Elkins home so early on a work day. They were even more surprised when Mrs. Elkins appeared in the open window of their apartment as he called to her, "You know that good job you love so much at the hospital? You might want to go apply for it. They just got an opening." The family loved to tell that story, especially the boys. The two youngest of the four sons, Spinoza, Horace named him after the philosopher, and Raymond, thought it was funny. But Horace Jr., the oldest boy, already in his mid-20s yet still living at home, felt differently. To him, there was nothing amusing about a black man having to subject himself to oppression in any form. Now, Eddie, the second oldest, felt that story and what it said about his father gave him justification to walk away from all kinds of situations he couldn't tolerate. Horace Sr. was none too happy about that. Emma took Horace's plate back to the stove to fill it once again. He thanked her with a nod of his head, apparently hungry, though lost in his own thoughts. Emma went back to the counter to finish packing lunches, thinking to herself of the day when Eddie was 18, not long after enlisting in the armed services, that Horace found his son had shown up unannounced on his doorstep. "What you doing here?" Horace Sr. asked, scrutinizing his slender, good-looking son.
"I'm on leave."
"Well, let me see your leave papers." Eddie pulled a map from his uniform pocket. It was a map of the United States, folded to a section of the Midwest, with Cleveland circled in red. Eddie slapped it down on the table. "There's my leave papers!" Horace sent his son directly back, but Eddie went AWOL a few more times, even to the point of having a couple of MPs turn up on Parkwood to haul him off yet again. Before long, Eddie was given a dishonorable discharge, and he returned to his parents' house, no worse for the wear. Sometimes Eddie could be trouble. That early Thursday morning, Emma stood in her kitchen and worried about her son Eddie. The dreamer, the artist, the fighter. Goodness, he had a gift. A singing voice that flowed from him like the angels put it there as a surprise for anyone lucky enough to hear. And a way with words, in speaking and in the poems and letters he wrote. She had a keepsake box filled with his writing. And he was beautiful. All her children were attractive, all tall, all with unusual colored eyes, ranging from brown to green to silver. But Eddie's eyes, they were something else, something out of this world. Emma had heard some parents called him Swami because they said Eddie hypnotized the girls into doing what he wanted. That worried her. Not because she believed it, but because she understood those parents' fears. After all, she had four daughters of her own to look out for. Ida, the eldest of her girls, could take care of herself. Intelligent and independent, a nurse no less, she had already married and moved away to Chicago. Anne, her second oldest girl, kind and warm, was still cautious. That was good. But with the twins, even in their teens, it seemed the boys were much too interested for Emma's liking. The same was true of Eddie. There was never a time Emma could recall that he didn't have at least one girl coming around for him. Eddie was charming, but he had a mean side, too. An unpredictable temper that could explode on anyone at all. Emma was the only one whose warnings he'd even consider. "Be careful, boy," she was forever telling him. "Stay out of trouble." What she meant was, "Eddie, you're different. You're special. I got such plans for you." Of course, all her babies were special, different, and she wanted the best for all of them, education and college. For her daughters' safe and loving homes, for her sons, better chances to raise themselves up and become men of substance, stature. They all showed promise. Horace Jr. with his ideas about changing society. Spinoza, ambitious. Maybe a little too ambitious. And her youngest, Raymond, always drawing and painting, making up his stories you couldn't half believe, but always did because you wanted to. But Eddie, he was like something extra magic, like a person who could go out there and win, a person who could really be somebody, somebody big in the world, an author or a poet. Emma saw that Horace had finished eating. Should she tell him about Eddie's decision to go to Chicago? She wanted to tell him about Frances, the mother of Eddie's two daughters, and the latest trouble, so Horace would talk to his son. But what to say? Emma went silently to his side. She filled his coffee cup, took his plate and utensils, wiped down the table. Horace Elkins was a no-nonsense man. If she told him about Eddie's plans to go stay in Chicago at Ida's, where there were more opportunities for nightclub singing, Horace would be all for it. But should she tell him that Eddie was intent on getting Francis and the girls out of the house because Francis's stepfather was being released from jail after serving time for molesting her, his own stepdaughter, not to mention that the man had given her a child? Should she tell him that Eddie was insane over the idea that the stepfather would return and repeat his actions with Francis and Eddie's two daughters? Emma wanted her husband to put down his foot and make sure Eddie didn't go by there anymore. A month ago, Eddie went over with a gun, threatening Francis to take the girls to go live at his sister Anne's. When that didn't work, a couple of weeks after that, Eddie went over again, and Francis's stepbrother took out a 12-gauge shotgun and fired at him, buckshot grazing his pants legs. What Eddie was trying to accomplish, Emma knew, was the right thing, but he was going about it the wrong way. No, Emma reconsidered, she didn't want to upset Horace in the morning. Working the two jobs and trying to make house calls on his patients in the neighborhood, he had enough weighing on him. Better to bring it up that evening. Horace tore himself from his own reverie, glanced up at his wife, and gave her a look. What is it? Never mind, she said, and placed her hand on Horace's shoulder as he stood up. It's hot already, Horace said at the open door. Emma gave him his lunch can. They said a fast goodbye, and she stood there, leaning on the doorpost, watching him leave, aware of the warming air rising from the lake. Horace was halfway down the sidewalk when he stopped, hit hard again by a wave of uncertainty. He had sat through breakfast, wanting to tell his wife, but not wanting to worry her. From the look of her, she already had enough on her mind. No, Horace decided, it was nothing. And he continued along his route to work, away from his home where, after this day, nothing again would ever be the same. The rest of the Elkins household was now waking up. Soon Horace Jr. and Spinoza had eaten and gone. After them, Emma laid out food for the twins and Raymond, giving the three enough time to eat and grab their books and lunches before she hurried them off to school. She was cleaning up the dishes when Eddie appeared in the kitchen doorway, grinning from ear to ear. "What you grinning about?" Emma asked, unable to resist the contagion of his smile. "I don't know, Mama," Eddie shrugged. He was dressed in his special black suit. He didn't sit, not wanting to put any creases where they didn't belong. His hair, conked, parted on the side, and slicked back, was immaculate. He stood by the window, catching a breeze that seemed to keep him cool.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.